So what is the gender data gap? And women saying that they're underrepresented and getting a hard time, do we really care? Well, you should. Hi, I'm Chris, I'm a doctor, I'm interested in health data, and I thought given it's International Women's Day today, 2020, I'd summarise a book to help you understand some of the complexities in this interesting, thorny issue. So in essence, if you've got a data set and women are underrepresented, there's actually a presumption that each individual in that is a male, usually a white male, and that's actually causing a data gap. And whiteness and maleness can only go without saying because most other identities aren't actually said at all. But because of this presumption that somebody is a male by default, there is a data gap, and that means that women aren't seen. And potentially they're not even remembered, because male data makes up the majority of what we actually know when it comes to being seen as universal. I'll tell you a bit more. This isn't just about women and data though. Women frequently didn't even have a broad name recognition, because a woman barely has to die before she's forgotten, or when we consign her work to a gender data gap by attributing her work to a man's. And if you look at emojis, by default, these were men, not women. If you look at the languages, Spanish, for example, if you're referring to a group of people, they are men by default, unless you specify that there is a woman there. And even if you have your translation app, the default will be it is a man. So let's think about this in a wider context. Traffic planning, surely you'd say that cannot be in any way discriminating against women. Well, the book strongly argues that it does, in part because most of the planning people are men. And what then happens is they consider themselves as the user, and they think, oh, I need to commute to work and back. So therefore, they'll prioritize measures at that point. However, women compared to men tend to do more childcare and caring duties, often requiring shorter visits that perhaps are not just going into the office before all this remote working came across. And they may even go by foot. So assisting the commuter drive may not actually help women. And if you look at even when snow's being cleared, you'd think, well, we'll just clear the roads because the pavements, you know, that's not as important. But it's the women who use the pavements more. So even something like that can help men more than women. Let's talk about toilets. Now, the book says that women take 2.3 times longer to use a toilet than a man. I don't know how they got that figure. I suspect they just referenced it from it somewhere else, but they didn't use a stopwatch or anything. But it's plausible. Women menstruate. They also can get UTIs more frequently. And the author argues that this 50-50 split male toilet, female toilet is unjust, in part because the men use urinals, which can take up less space, but mainly because the women take longer, and you'd often see in venues a much longer queue for the toilets than for females than for males. Although urinals aren't the best things, and you've got less privacy. However, if you look at this in the developing world context, where people often don't have the privilege of having toilets and good access to these, then often people will go and do their business on the street, and they'd often wait till after dark. And then unfortunately women are at a higher risk of being attacked or sexually assaulted as a consequence. US universities, these actually provide another example of where the gender blind leave policies can end up actually discriminating against women. Because if you speak to US academics, they're all obsessed with tenure, and this is when they've basically got a permanent job, which is often very well paid compared to academics in the UK anyway. What they've got is a bias system in which you've got about 7 years between completing your PhD and receiving tenure. And that usually would be somebody about the age 30 to 40. And that coincides with the ages people are more likely to have babies. And the argument here is that the women spend more time looking after babies than the men do. And if you actually have good intentions and you think, well, I will design an algorithm that will eliminate any data bias, what you may find is that it may not help you, because it could learn from previous people's work and see that men appear to do more than women, so therefore a male name may be prompted as the better employee over a female. And arguably, you could say, well, Chris, that's because the men do more work. But it's actually that the women, a lot of the work they do is unpaid and essentially unaccounted for, which would make a woman appear less productive than a man. And even there have been algorithms designed to say, well, we found that the people who contribute actively to this particular website may be a better employee than somebody who contributes less to the particular website. But again, that discriminates against women because they've got less time as a whole because they're doing more unpaid caring duties. There is no easy answer here, but it's something that is worth being aware of. And particularly if you're in AI and you're making algorithms, you have to think about this. Let's talk less abstract and talk about chainsaws and tools. Well, most of these are actually designed for a man's hand, not a woman's hand. Typically, a man has larger hands than women. And that means that if a woman is using a chainsaw, or perhaps they're putting on their stab vest that is designed for a man's figure, not a woman's figure, they're less likely to use the machine as designed and more likely to have an accident. The book mentioned about a female police officer whom had to buy her own stab vest, then got disciplined for this because the male design one was just so uncomfortable she was taking it off and potentially at more risk of death in the line of duty. Even piano keys for the musicians out there, they're designed for the larger hands, and women pianists can potentially get sorer hands because of this. I think that there's a 3/4 size piano key that's designed, and that's better for women. Car crashes, RTAs, RTCs, whatever you call them, they're bad. And you'd say, well, men are more likely than women to be involved in a car crash. And that means that they potentially dominate the car crash numbers. But when you actually have a woman who is involved in the car crash, she's more likely to be seriously injured than a man. And the book mentions this is because really the car itself has been designed for a man who's a bit taller. So in essence, a woman with shorter legs, and this is all generalizing, I'll just point out, because obviously there are taller women and shorter men, but a woman who has typically shorter legs, in essence, appears out of place to the car and how it should be driven. So they're not in a standard seating position. They're an out of position driver, and potentially they could be, as a consequence, more likely to be injured in the accidents that they're involved in. Now, crash dummies were first introduced in the 1950s, but they were actually based on a man. It was a 1.77 meter tall dummy that weighs 76 kilograms. To be honest with you, now this would be quite a small man, but that was more than the heavier and taller than the average woman. And the muscle mass of the dummy is actually in male proportions. So you may have heard about a female car crash test dummy. And these were designed, but seemingly they only put them in the passenger seats when testing, and it was only optional up until about 2011. So then what you also find if you examine the US statistics is that the people who died were only counted as the drivers. So in essence, and unfortunately, I mean, the book suggests that if there's a man and a woman in a car, usually the man's driving. I don't know why that is, but that's apparently the gender norm. And basically, the female crash dummy would only be put in the passenger seat. And then when they said, well, it's led to a reduction, it hasn't at all, because the female drivers, who if they sadly die in a road traffic accident, they actually haven't been tested with that particular dummy. Now, hopefully that's changed. The Department of Work and Pensions isn't collecting sex disaggregated data on who the money is actually going to. And when merely comparing female-headed to male-headed households, there wasn't much of a gender difference in poverty levels. However, when poverty was assessed on an individual level, there was a dramatic difference, with 71% of those living in poverty being women. And within those living in poverty, it was women who experienced the greatest level of deprivation. And it suggests that these assumptions that poverty can be determined at a household level and that female-headed households are the same as, in terms of poverty, as male-headed households are just simply wrong, as they're based on this faulty data and non-gender sensitive analysis. And potentially this perpetuates this gender data gap. You may have heard about these concepts in social psychology, like naive realism, and also at times it's called projection bias. Well, essentially it's when people tend to assume that their own way of thinking about things is typical, just like the example I mentioned earlier about traffic. Well, that's just normal, and the difficulty is, for white men, this bias is potentially magnified, because then in the boardroom, you see other white men who then amplify that experience back to them, making it seem more typical. And so this projection bias, amplified by a confirmation bias, if you like, actually goes quite a long way to explaining why it's so common to find male bias masquerading as gender neutrality. If the majority of people are in power are men, as they actually are, then the majority of people in power won't see this. Male bias just looks like common sense to them. But in fact, common sense is the product of the gender data gap